Hello and welcome to my Tech Fan. My name is Igor and it is time for a product review again. And this time it is the Voxelab Aquila, and this package is sent to me by Voxelab for the review. I don't have to send it back, I can keep this printer, but my opinion will be independent from this. It's not a secret, it is the cheap alternative for Ender3 V2 3D printer, because they have very similar specification. It has a silent stepper motor drivers, it has a textured glass surface, it has the tensioners on the timing belts, color display. So very similar specifications like Ender3 V2, but it is much cheaper. Currently I check it is $179, so approximately $70 or $80 cheaper than Ender3 V2 with the same or similar, very similar specification and the structure. Since this is commonly recommended as for those who want to enter into the 3D printing world, so I will get a little bit more into details in this video. So I will show you the assembling, even the bed leveling, but if you want to skip this part, you have the contents with the timestamps in the description, so you can skip to the part you would like to see, like, I don't know, 3D printing or something like that. Okay, so let's see what's in the box. Okay, I have this warning to switch the power unit, depend if you are in US then to 115, or in Europe for example 230. Okay, so I will check that when I take it out. Classic packaging with this black foam, so that definitely the printer is protected during the shipping. Some sample PLA, some zip ties and after sales service. Let's take out the smaller part first. This is the color display. This is the extruder with the stepper motor, and yes, very similar like on Ender3 V2, unfortunately it's from the plastic. This is part of the spool holder, probably holder for the screen. Alloy extrusion, probably from the X-axis profile, gentry profile for X-axis. And this is the base of the printer. It is quite assembled, so basically I will not have to work too much with it. Second level, power cable, spatula for removing the printed object, some tools, screwdrivers, open-end wrench, Allen keys. I can see here some timing belt, micro SD card with the SD card reader, pack of the bolts and screw nuts, two more alloy extrusions, and the lead screw is inside one alloy extrusion, so it is definitely protected during the shipping. Stepper motor for the Z axis. I'm not sure, maybe this is cover for the end of the X-axis. There is a limit switch. This is tensioner for timing belt. Another part for the spool holder. This is passive block for the X-axis probably. And another power cable. Yes, I need this one and not this one. Okay, interesting. And that's it. So it looks like they have the same packaging for different countries. So definitely this will be my first step before I forget it, to check the power unit. Is it set to 230 volts, which I need here in Europe? Yes, it's 230. In my case, it's okay. Well, I will just follow the 3D printing user manual, which was included in the packaging. The hardware part includes 8 steps, and then comes the wiring, and then bend leveling, and how to start printing. And here you can see the wire connection. Of course, I don't have to do this. These wires are already connected on the main board. but I'm not familiar with this Aquila mainboard version 1.0. Okay, let's start with the first step. First step, installation of Z-axis limit switch kit and Z-axis profiles. For this, I will need the Z-axis profile, left and right. The left one is the with the limit switch. And I will need this M5x45 bolts. I will start with the right Z-axis profile. I notice this is the additional protection for the lead screw. It was inside. And it looks like it is symmetric, so it doesn't matter which part is up. And all I have to do is to screw it with these two bolts from the bottom side. Not the other side. So the, on the left, the Z-axis, this is the limit switch. Of course, it has to be on the bottom and to the left side. So this is its correct position. And before you tie these two bolts, make sure that you didn't pinch the cable between two oil extrusions. Step 2 is installing the Z-axis motor kit and the T-type screw. For this I will need the lead screw, the stepper motor and the M4x20 bolts. Now, before you start, it is very important to check. I noticed that it's a very common problem. And even in my case, this is not completely flat, these two surfaces. So what I will do, I will lose these two bolts. Now I can move it a little bit freely and put this on some flat surface and then tie these two bolts again. And now this is in one plane, these two surfaces. I will insert the lead screw in the coupling and I will tighten the upper bolt. Then with these two bolts screwing into holes into this oil extrusion. Step 3 is installing the pneumatic joint, XE axis kit and synchronous belt. So I will need this yellow extrusion. They are labeled, but if you already take it out, the longer one is the correct one. And as I can see, it is symmetric, so it's not important where will I start. This one is easier, but the other one is a little bit tricky because it goes inside. Pneumatic joint goes here. And tight it with provided open-end wrench. And the belt goes around this pulley. Step 4, installation the extrusion kit and Z-axis passive block. So approximately this is the position, so the extruder is on the top, and then in that case the nozzle is on the bottom. And leave this end free. I'm installing now the passive block. So the wheels goes on the back side. They are in the same line like already these wheels. And so far I'm installing only one screw. The other will be added after I place a tensioner on it. Step 5, installing the X-axis tensioner. First remove the knob and take out the pulley. Move the belt around the idler pulley. Then insert back the passive block. There is a groove and it goes on the side where the passive block is. Let's place back the knob, but don't tighten it.
yet. Now I'll screw in this M5 bolt on one side first. And on the other side should go some M5 countersunk screw, but I couldn't find it in my kit. So I'm just using a regular M5 by 12 with the rounded head on the other side. And now let's insert the end of the belts into these slots. And now I can add some tension by rotating this knob. Not too much, I will adjust this much later. Now I'm installing this X-axis limit switch, and also it is a cover for this pulley. Step 6, installing the Z-axis moving kit and adjusting the tightening of the timing belt. So these wheels goes into these slots on our extrusion, and also we have to insert this lead screw inside this nut. The manual says that in this step 6 we should check the tension on the timing belts, but the y-axis is already assembled correctly. As you can see, I hope there is a gap between the yellow extrusion and the belt, and when I apply some smaller force I can press it, so this says the correct tension. If not, then I can adjust it with this knob here. Something similar tension you have to have here with this x-axis. Be careful, because just a little bit more torque on this knob and you can apply much big force here, pulling force on the timing belt. But the tension should be similar, like on y-axis, as I explained earlier. And we can move to the step 7, installing the Genty profile and display kit. Installing the Genty profile is very simple, just screw in the 4 bolts on the top. Only pay attention that this is hole for the head, so this goes up. Let's install the screen bracket. It goes here. First, close these T-nuts, but don't take them off. Align them in this position so you can insert them in this slot, and when you rotate the bolts they will rotate to 90 degrees and lock in the position. Step 8, installing the spool holder and a Genty cover. Two bolts from one side and T-nuts from the other side. It's very important the position of the T-nuts. Insert T-nuts into slots. And they should rotate 90 degrees and lock in the position. And now we can place this Genty cover on both sides. Step 9, wire connection. All wires are labeled, so it's very easy. This is the Z limit switch, the smaller one, and the longer, bigger one is for the stepper motor. This is the X-axis stepper motor and the limit switch. And X limit switch.
E is for the extruder.
Now, I'm not sure if I skipped this step somewhere, but it is very important before you turn it on to check these wheels. Usually on one side the wheels are fixed, but the opposite side there is an eccentric nut. So we have wheels on eccentric nut here, here and here, three, and we have two on the y-axis. So now I can rotate this wheel with my hand. So this is not tight, so I will need an open-end wrench and rotate this eccentric nut until I cannot rotate the wheel with my hand. Okay. And I have to repeat this with the other wheels. And on the y-axis we have two eccentric nuts. This step is extremely important to get a nice quality printing. Connect the Bowden tube and lock it with this clip. Pushing completely to the end, lift up this locker. I like to add some lubricant on the lead screw. It's time to remove the protection foil from the printing surface. I don't know why do I have that deja vu feeling, like error in the matrix. It looks very similar to the Ender3 V2. The difference is the display is in horizontal position, not vertical position. Unfortunately, we don't have that tool holder here, but theoretically there is a space between this plate, but it's not there. But everything else is very similar. We have the same tension as here, the same plastic extruder. I think the hot end is also similar or the same. One lead screw for the Z-axis, spool holder on the top, place for the SD card. Before I start with bed leveling, I want to be sure that the nozzle will not hit the printing surface during the first auto-homing. So first I will check manually if the limit switch will stop the nozzle before it touches the bed. I'm rotating the lead screw with my hand and follow the position of the nozzle, and it touched the bed now, but I'm quite far away from the limit switch, so I will compress the springs and probably I have to lift the limit switch higher. So when the limit switch is pressed, then I still have approximately 2 millimeters between nozzle and the printing surface. So on first auto homing, it will not hit the bed. And now the printer should be ready for turning it on. One more time, check if the power of the power supply unit is set correctly for your country. I'm plugging the power cable and turning on the printer first time. That was fast booting. Control. I want to check the moving of the x-axis. Okay, y-axis. That is it. Okay, stepper motors are working correctly. Now I can go for to first auto home.
And the nozzle stopped approximately 1 millimeter from the printing surface.
After auto homing, I am disabling the stepper motors. Now I can move it with my hand. Always move it slowly. And move above the first knob. And with a piece of paper, I will use this after sale service paper. Rotate the knob until you can feel some friction between nozzle and the paper. Then move to the next knob, exactly above it. Third knob. And repeat this two or three times until you don't get perfect friction in all four corners, and then last check in the center. Great. Bread is leveled. Let's move a little bit higher the Z-axis. I will do some test prints, but I'm not even sure how big are those models. But anyway, I will try this simple filament. Let's preheat the nozzle and the bed, so I'm going to control. I have here preheat PLA. Cut the end of the filament under a 45 degree angle. I always recommend for the first print to use some G-code provided by manufacturer on the SD card, because if there is some problem, you know that is not resulted by the slicing software. During the printing we can see the progress. There is a stop button, a pause button, and properly here we can adjust some... it's a touch screen. Printing speed, nozzle temperature, let's say the bed temperature 62, just for testing. We can adjust the Z offset. So these things we can adjust during the printing. This is from Ender3 V2. Printing surface cooled down. Now theoretically this should be easy to remove, but you will see if I need a spatula. Oh, that was easy. So this textured glass working. If I left it to cool down, then it's very easy to remove. Nice, a little bit more stringing on the top of this pyramid. I didn't have enough time to cool down here, but otherwise, nice. It had some problems here with the overhang. Probably weaker part cooling. But the surface is very nice. On this part it can be visible that how nice is the surface even in the Z direction. And now I want to prepare the Cura slicer to slice my own object, which will be a benchy, which is quite some kind of benchmark for 3D printing.
This is the content of the SD card, so we have here the G-codes. I printed this on Aquila test model. User manual, software, this is Cura zip file, I'll check that later. And there are some models, STL files. And I notice here very useful things, for example, rotation nut and the toolbox. Here we have some images of those. So printed the rotation nut for the extruder. I used the Ender3 V2. But also you can see here, this is the toolbox, very useful. You can attach it here on the side of the printer. You have another option for the spool holder. So probably my next printing will be the rotation knob and the benchy. But for that I have to use the Cura, and I will have to add this printer. Here we have the Cura file, but it's better if you use the latest version. Search for Ultimaker Cura and download that file. Let's add the printer to Cura. Add printer, not network printer, and the Voxelab is not in the list, so I'll just add Ender3 V2 or Pro. Ender3 Pro, and here I will rename it. So these fields are now filled correctly because it has the same dimensions and the same size of the extruder. Let's try the standard quality. I will just import now the rotation nut, which is on the SD card. Maybe I will change just a few things. I will use 3 lines and 30% infill. 1 hour and 20 minutes of printing, and this is the preview. Same I will do with the benchy, and then print these two objects. I'm preparing the next printing. I'm cleaning the surface with some isopropyl alcohol. Rotation. Surface cooled down, now let's see if it will be easy to remove it. It's a little bit harder than the previous one. Okay. Let's take a closer look. Very nice printing, absolutely no problems with it. And I'll replace this one. The bed is cooled down, now let's try to remove the benchy. Very nice surface. Not the best color to present the printing quality. I can see a few strings only here, I hope it's visible on camera too. But no problems with the part cooling. The bridging, well, it was okay now. So actually this is a better benchy than with my Ender3 V2 for the first time with the different settings. Another conclusions, well, the main question is that can Voxelab Aquila be an alternative for Ender3 V2? I couldn't compare them directly side by side in a video because my Ender3 V2 is a highly upgraded version now. It has at least 5-6 big upgrades on it. But the answer is definitely yes. I got the same or maybe even a little bit better printing quality, but don't forget that depends a lot not only about the settings, but the V-slot wheels, the tension on the belt. So depend of a lot of things Even the Ender3 V2 or Voxelab Aquila can print even better than the push-up, for example, but with a lot of tweaking and experimenting. Few things I'm missing with the Voxelab Aquila, and one of that is the rotary knob on the extruder, but it is included on SD card, so we can print it ourselves, like I did. And on Ender3 V2, we have a tool holder here. Here, probably because of the screen, we cannot, there is no space for it, but we have included the tool holder on SD card, and we can print it and attach it here on the side. What I'm missing between tools is the pliers. It's not included with the Voxelab Aquila. And also, I'm not a big fan of the sample filaments. During the printing of the benchy, I almost had 3 times failed print because this fall down from the spool holder. I noticed on time, but imagine, so this printer is recommended commonly as a first printer. So some beginner will start with the printing and maybe he will have the failed print just because the sample filament will fall down from the spool holder. And more often I can see that new printers arrive with the small sample filaments on the rolls, so it is less risky that we will have a failed print just because we have here tangle of, I don't know, jam, filament jam, because, or maybe they will fall down. One another thing I didn't like, and those are fans. As I mentioned, this is very similar to Ender3 V2, and unfortunately those fans are quite equal, so it is silent, it has silent stepper motor drivers, so I cannot hear the stepper motors during the printing, but I can hear the fans, so they are loud as on Ender3 V2. I mean, this is a very big opportunity. If they want to be an Ender3 V2 alternative, Voxelab, Aquila, they could improve here. So this is very big space, and in marketing they could tell that, oh, here it is, Ender3 V2 alternative, but it could be much quieter. But it's not. So, of course, there are a lot of solutions, so you can search on the internet how to make this fans, not only these fans, but also the power and motherboard from the bottom, so they can be replaced, but be careful because the voltage is maybe different of those fans which you will use. Yes, unfortunately they didn't use this opportunity to make Ender3 V2 alternative, but much quieter. And size, the Voxelab Aquila has very similar structure as Ender3 V2. A lot of upgrades which are made for Ender3 V2 we can use on Voxelab Aquila. And just few words which are equal for both printers. Which upgrades I recommend immediately? Of course, one of them is the rotary knob on the extruder and some kind of filament guide. And you can search for filament guide Ender3 V2. They will be compatible with the Voxelab Aquila. Those you can print yourself, and which you can buy, but they are not too expensive. Definitely a replacement for these springs, with those yellow springs with flat surfaces. They are much stronger and you don't have to level the bed so often. Extruder is from plastic. Until it works, it's okay, but if it breaks, then definitely I will recommend to replace it with the metallic version. And maybe if you want to print more on higher temperature, for example, to use that as I think it's maximum 250 degrees Celsius, then I would recommend replacing this Teflon tube with something like Capricorn tube or something like that, which can handle higher temperature. With this tube, I wouldn't recommend going above 240 degrees Celsius, for example. That was my experience and my opinion about this printer. I hope it was useful. And thank you for watching. Happy printing!